welcome from my side. Welcome everyone to today's first Process Automation Tech Talk. Yeah, also in these challenging times, I hope everyone is doing really well. And in today's Tech Talk, I would like to talk about how can you strengthen your competitiveness in these rapidly changing times. And hereby, I would like to ask you some questions. So first of all, would you like to reduce your batch recipe time by over 40% at industry scale? Or would you like to improve your economics by tens of millions per year? What would you say if a design modification result in a 25% increase in filtration capacity? Or by operating your plant closer to the limits, saving 10 to 40 millions per year? Or what would you say if you can achieve your sustainability goals by saving 3 to 15% of energy costs per year? And what would you say if all these examples are real examples? So the question is, how can we achieve such goals? So the key enabler here is existing customers typically use digital process twins across the plant life cycle. And what do I mean by these digital process twins, and how do they evolve, and how does it work exactly? So if we consider a typical plant life cycle, which is shown here on the screen, we start with the design of the process on the left side. Just try to activate my pointer. So we start with the design of the process, where we combine experimental data from the lab with process models to find the best design. The design of the process continues by creating a flow sheet and run design optimization to optimize your process units like reactors, column towers, and the likes, until of the design of the whole process plant. Once the point is reached where you have the PFDs, P90s ready, the design of the process plan and the design of the process plan is finished, the engineering of the plant begins. So we are then coming to the digital engineering phase. And this means the design of the automation, control structure, the logic, and the likes. In the next important milestone is the commissioning phase. Here's the idea to test basically the units, each equipment, and then the overall plant until we come to the digital operations phase, where the product performance is a key, the quality of the product and the maintenance comes into play in that phase. And typically, there are many digital twins emerging across the plant life cycle. So typically, you start with the process design twin, you have, for example, the digital automation twin. We have the digital twin for field and process. We have the digital twin for documentation and planning. And we have maybe a fluid dynamic simulation, which is also a digital twin, and a digital twin for operations. And last but not least, a digital twin for the physical assets. And the key now for reaching the next level of competitiveness is the combination of existing digital twins across the plant lifecycle, so that you basically secure your investment and benefit from your existing digital twins. Some of you maybe heard that last year PSE became part of the Siemens family. So we have now a strong partner which support you and of course also Siemens to achieving these goals, combining digital twins across the plant life cycle. And this not only means for greenfield, but also for brownfield plants. So we can apply digital twins and create everyday value by doing so. And most important is here that you start somewhere and capture your knowledge, which create then daily value for your plant. So let's have a closer look in that value creation, how it works in detail. And here I would like to give you an example by doing that whole evolvement of the process twin based on a process design twin. So we start at the design phase. And the question here is, what is a useful model for the design, and what is a useful model then later for the operation? So the first question is the right level of detail. And the right level of detail is covers key phenomena like a heat transfer between pellets, for example, and reactors, or exothermic reactions. The model is validated with experimental data. The objective here is to find values of unknown model parameters, like kinetic parameters, for example, reaction exponentials or activation energies. It is accurate enough, that's really important, to support optimization-based process design. And by that means applying rigorous mathematical optimization. And some of the decision variables you usually have in such optimization studies are, for example, the tube side, the diameter of a tube, the length, the number of layers, the catalyst, the shape of the pellet, for example. On the shell side, you have decision variables like number of positioning of cooling circuits and the cooling water flow. And finally, when this model is accurate enough and suitable for scale up, we can then benefit from an interface which is called hybrid modeling interface, where you can, for example, combine a CFD model with that GPROMS physics-based model. And with that high predictive model, you can create applications for soft sensing, for future prediction, for dynamic optimization, and this creates everyday value for you. And the key technology is here for doing this optimization, the industry-leading optimization capability of PSE. And I will talk later a little bit about what that means exactly. So let's have a further look into the key technology, what is required to build these models, and what is basically used to optimize these models for your daily operation. So here on the screen, you see the heart of the digital design, and this is the modeling platform. So you can see a typical screenshot of a process flow sheet. On the left side, you see the project tree, which is here. In the middle, you have the working window where you drag and drop the library objects, and the library objects basically capture all your knowledge, or it is the knowledge which is existing in GPROMS in several libraries. And by using them, per drag and drop, you design basically here your flow sheet. And the key element here is are the models from the process libraries. And you can also create your own models. So there are some custom modeling capabilities provided by GPROMS, which you then can use to create your own models and use them in such a flow sheet. So once this model is being created, that flow sheet model, you can start create a value by, for example, running a simulation to get a better understanding of the process, or you run a global system analysis. It's a kind of Monte Carlo simulation, which is used to explore the operation space. And you can run the rigorous mathematical optimization to maximize the economics of this process, to design, for example, the columns, the reactors, and these are really the key elements for the digital design, these global system analysis tools and the optimization capability of GPROMS. So once this model is accurate and predictive enough, we can then benefit from them, from this model, also in the operations phase. And how does that work? We can see on the next slide, where we already, in the commissioning phase, so what you see here on the left side is the real plant. So on the top, we have the operator screen, followed by the automation level, where the automation program runs in an automation system. So typically within Siemens, we have 410, for example, which you use to execute the code. And after the automation level, we have the field level with all the actuators and the sensors. And they control and monitor the process itself on the bottom left of the pyramid here. So this is typically a result after the commissioning phase when the plant is in operation. So now to accelerate the commissioning phase and have a faster time to market, Siemens has developed a tool called CIMIT for virtual commissioning to support you during the engineering process and to speed up your real commissioning. So CIMIT here on the right side on the automation level mimics the automation and the field level, which enables you to do basic tests of your automation program at the very early stage. And in the process level here on the right bottom side, we can now benefit from the previous investment. So the model we have created with that GPROMS platform, we can connect now to CIMIT and create, by doing that, that virtual plant, which is here in the blue area on the right side. And then we can use that virtual plant to do operator training, what if scenarios, and the likes. In the next phase, we take that model and deploy it online. So we take it and deploy it online, which means we create an additional layer. And that layer is called here on the slide, Intelligent Digital Operations level. And to add also a security level, we developed a platform to do that as easy as possible. And that platform proves, for example, all the inputs and the outputs and check if they are in the bounds. In addition, this platform can perform different calculations like real-time optimization or soft sensing or even future prediction. And the key is really that it's continuously monitoring the real plant on the left side here and keep your model up to date. And by doing that, in combination with the optimization capability, we create this day-to-day value for you. And here it's really important that it's DCS independent. And it can, of course, be connected also to your existing HMI via additional faceplates, for example. So now I would like to give you some real examples and how this technology were used and what kind of value were created. So here we see a utility plant. In typical utility systems, we have external supplies like fuels, steam and electricity, and more equipment to deal with like boilers, gas turbines here, to generate the power, waste heat recovery. The steam itself, it's used in the process, and the process itself generates energy. So in total, it is a really complex system to deal with. And it's online 24/7. So the pressure for operators to get a handle on this increases a lot. Another aspect here when we deal with utilities is the operation strategy. So there are several strategies you can think of. So for example, a long-term strategy. Here we talk about years. There is also, for example, short-term tactical planning, where we typically think about months, or you have a daily strategy. And this requires a dynamic optimization. And the targets, the saving targets, are typically for a well-operated plant, 2 to 3%. For not well-managed ones, we look at 5 to 10%, which is a return of investment of 9 to 12 months. Quite often, customers perform an energy audit, but the problem here is that they create short-term saving. And when fouling, for example, occurs during operation, the behavior of the plant changes continuously. So you need to then perform another energy audit, which is not as sufficient. So here we think of a solution, or we thought of a solution which is a dynamic optimization for such a utility system. So this is really crucial to daily optimize such a system. But before I come to the solution, I would like to mention some typical challenges for such an online optimization. One of the challenges is to know how much electricity is being generated on site by boilers, by gas turbines, and so on. And how much do I need to bought from energy supplier? And this, of course, you need to know the electricity price, for example, to have a good prediction of your economics. And this electricity prices changes by hours. Another challenge is the steam distribution. How efficient is it in such a plant? And how to deal with steam venting? And how can that be reduced? Another key aspect or another challenge is finding the optimal operating point for the boilers and the turbines. And how to manage then the demand of such utilities and in the most efficient way. So these are key challenges for such a system. And the solution is here again based on first principle models. So GPROMs provide a library which is called G Utilities with all the mentioned assets, and with the accurate constraints, we are able to perform these rigorous mathematical optimization. So there is no need for trial and error, changing, for example, the input and see what are the results are. So this is really like and key technology to find the optimum operating point. And here on the bottom right, you can see a typical advisory dashboard for a utility prototype. And this is an online decision support tool for daily operation, and it's connected to the real plant, as shown earlier by this automation pyramid. And the model always is up to date by performing, for example, parameter estimation, and it delivers based on this mathematical optimization calculation daily value. And this results, for example, in that project in a saving of 1.5 to 3 million per year. In the next example, I would like to introduce you to the low density polyethylene process. So what you see here on the screen is a typical autoclave reactor, and in polymerization polymerization reactors are typically producing different grades. The property of these grades depend on the structure of the polymer, long or short structure, and the key quality parameter of such a polymer is melt flow index and melt flow density. So, and we typically deal in industry with two reactor types. So it's the tubular reactor and the autoclave reactor. And here on the left side, you see now an autoclave reactor. And this reactor has several segments with rotating shaft motors. It has temperature injections here on the right side on the shell. And it can be controlled independently. And typically, there are also 4 to 6 peroxide injection points along the shell. And the decision variables of such a process to change basically the quality of the polymers is the flow rate, for example, and feed temperature. And the big challenge here is to increase the conversion and maybe changing also the desired property of the polymer. So again, what you can do is trial and error, but this is too expensive and in today's environment not really appropriate. So another challenge here in this process is that these zones here, these segments here, are not perfectly mixed. So it's really challenging to create such a model. So what can you do to create an accurate model which predicts, for example, this polymer this molecular weight distribution? So we need to have a really accurate model to do that. And that model needs to have a really detailed kinetic to predict the shape of the molecular weight distribution. Doing a complex CFD simulation to perform such a model or to perform such a prediction is really, really demanding and therefore not really practical. So there must be a different solution. And in that case, what we did is we used two models, one CFD model unit for cold flow simulation and one G-Proms model with perfect steered reactors and full polymerization kinetics in combination then with this interface I mentioned, this hybrid CFD interface. We were able to create a really predictive accurate model which is able to predict here this molecular weight distribution. And then again, in combination with the optimization technology of G-Proms, we can then find the optimum operating point by changing the feed temperature, the set point of the temperature, the pressure, and that increased the productivity at this customer by 10%, while preserving the use, the end-use polymer properties. And this is quite crucial that you keep the quality of the polymer. Here you can see now on the next slide, on the next screen, how such a polymer reactor can be applied online. So on the screen you can see a typical operator screen, the reactor in the middle, some component feeds, a catalyst feed with typical temperature control and a level control here. Typically, the set point of the controls are derived from spec, and they come from, as mentioned, from spec, and they produce a certain desired quality, which you can see here now on the right top. The problem is now if, for example, disturbances occur, which can't be monitored. For example, here an impurity in the catalyst, and which results here, what you can see, in a decrease of the quality, and PIDs can't compensate that because it can't be monitored. And this, by switching on the model predictive control, which is then able to monitor this change, we are able to compensate this error quickly. And now you can see that behind this model predictive control sets the set point of all PIDs automatically. And this is quite important also for the next showcase here, where we want to change the grade of the polymer. And by doing that, we change the set point of the key performance indicators like melt flow index directly. So we don't have to look into our spec and derive the PID parameters. We do it directly. And this technology then drives the process to exactly the desired quality. So what is under, what is behind that? You can see on the right side. So on the right side here, you see the engineering studio of the nonlinear MPC. And in operation, as mentioned, all controllers, or this controller runs in the background embedded in that online application. And this online application is then connected to the DCS, which then set frequently these set points for these underlying PIDs. And at the moment we are in trial where we test this technology with a customer in the US and in Germany as well. Now I would like to go into a different industry domain. So here you can see a spray drying process. And spray dryers are widely used across different industry. So for example, in pharmaceutics, food and bath for milk and coffee and other industry, ceramics and paint and blood, for example, it's also used. The advantage of this spray dryer here is a rapid drying. The control of the product attributes and reproducibility is also a big advantage of that spray dryer. The key question here is also in terms of optimization. So when you want to, for example, have a higher moisture content, how to dry the droplets in an optimum way. So there are typical two stages of drying, a constant rate of drying and a falling rate drying. And the challenge here is that there are different shapes emerges through that drying process, and this impact, of course, the quality of the product. And further challenges is that this also changes the drying process later on in the process. So for example, if you have then increased fouling in your spraying dryer. Typically, here we talk about four different models, so which you can apply for different design aspects or different operation aspects. So we have here on the left side a simple model. This simple model does mass and energy balance. It's good for the initial process design. We have a more accurate kinetic model for population balance, for detailed description of the kinetics, which is good for design optimization. And then a more detailed model, which is important if you not have a well mixed model. And at the end, again, you can combine the CFD simulation with the with a GPROMS model, where you then create a really accurate representation of your spray dryer. And here's, for example, on the right side, a thickness curve shown, and based on optimization studies, you design the process such that your operating point lies inside that thickness curve, which is the desired operating point. And once you have finished the design and make sure that made sure that the model is accurate and predictive, you can then apply this model online using the digital applications platform, which then performs, for example, soft sensing, real-time optimization, and this can increase up to 0.3 higher moisture content, which leads to an annual saving of approximately 1 million for such a spray dryer. Last but not least, I would like to give you some heads up about and cracking and furnace cracking process. So here on the left side, you see a typical furnace cracking process. And the key element here is to have a severity control, which drive your production to an optimal operating point. And I show you later in a short movie how this is being done and how the models and technology of GPROMS PSE is used to create daily value for the customer. And key aspect, as mentioned earlier, is the model, which needs to be accurate. You also, it's also required to have a optimum control to really achieve the desired severity. And this technology was also already implemented and create here a 2% enhancement of yield. And this also result in tens of millions of dollars per year for such a big plant. But let's have a look about the process and see how such a technology can be applied online. So here what you see on the screen is a gas cracking plant, ethylene plant, and typically you have two feeds, ethane and propane, and then there are these crackers. Here in that case we have seven crackers which operate at 850 degrees Celsius, and then we have some cold section units, compression units, and then we have the separation part where we then get the desired product, ethylene and propylene, which is then later being afterwards being used, for example, for polymerization plants. So here you see a typical operator screen. Here on the mid and in the middle you see the furnace. Here you have seen the hydrocarbon flow control, here the feed dilution steam control, and here we have the heat control. And there are two challenges here. The key variable of interest is the temperature in the coils, and these cannot be measured directly. So typically you have like a proxy control, and with this proxy control, when you get it wrong and you have a mismatch, this can lead to 1 million per year by just 1 degree of temperature of mismatch. And of course, a pure control and the buildup of fouling or coking here further increases the loss of your production plan. So the solution here is what you see on the screen is a soft sensor, and this soft sensor again uses this model online and predict accurate key performance indications, like for example coil outlet temperature, coke thickness, coking rate, and it in real time predicts ethylene and propylene, the key products here in that example. And by using a soft sensor, we are then able to basically have an advanced augmented operator screen where the operator sees in real time all these additional measurements, which are really hard to measure or not possible to measure. And then we can use these additional measurements, soft sense measurements, to apply dynamic optimization. So in that example, you see our MPC, model predictive control, and with this additional soft sense value, we are able to perform a significant control strategy, and this results into an increased profit of that process. Now the next question is, let me pause here for a second. Can I do that? Let me pause here for a second. The next question here is on the first screen you have seen seven furnaces, and the next question is how to set each furnace, how to set the set point of each furnace such that the overall plan runs efficiently. And here we use real-time optimization, so we have a model created for the whole ethylene plant, And then we applied this rigorous optimization technology of PSE and perform a real-time optimization. And as a result, we get for each furnace the optimum operating points. And here in this short screencast, I accelerate here a little bit the speed, because this is really time-consuming, and usually you need a really big machine to execute such complex optimizations. And once the solution is calculated, the operator can accept these values, and each unit, each furnace unit then perform a dynamic optimization by using, for example, the MPC. And then by doing that, we get the overall plant efficiency. So in the next sequence, I would like to give you also some insights in the run length prediction. So the run length prediction is a tool which you can use to create what-if scenarios. So on the left side, you see a table where the operator can type in some expected feeds in the future. So for example, let me pause here as well. So for example, day 5, he expect 56 percent of ethene conversion. On day 10, the operator expect another 56 percent of conversion. He can now change that, as shown here, to 67, for example, and this can then be typed in the table, and the operator can then run the run length prediction. And also here it's accelerated because it's quite time consuming to calculate that. And the result is that you get for each 5 days an predicted behavior. For example, for the max coke thickness, the operator can expect here, in that case, at day 10 here, for example, 7.5 millimeters of coke thickness. And on top, he sees how long he can run the furnace until he needs to make a decoking. And typically, you have every 60 days a decoking process. And with this technology, you can highly predict how long you can operate such an furnace. So here a short wrap-up of the industries we and PSE is focusing on. So here are three main pillars. So in oil and gas, we have a quite big expertise, which you see here on the name of customers, and also in chemical and petrochemical, and of course in pharma industry, where we have domain expertise in life science, agrochemicals, food and bath, and specialties in consumer goods. And there is also one column here. You see it's Honda and Toyota. Here we have another key domain expertise developed over the last years, which is for fuel cells. So we have really accurate models for fuel cells, which is used from Honda and Toyota, for example. With that, I would like to close and open for questions.